Good morning. I'm Bob Hancock, the lay leader with Luke here at First and Summerfield United Methodist Church. Last week, I was sitting in an easy chair reading a book about global education that our daughter Robin had written. It was the same chair that Robin used when she was engaging in her own global education, reading stories to children stuck inside because of the pandemic. I could look out the window and see the Hudson River, the Jersey Palisades, the George Washington Bridge. Today, I look out the window and I see grass begging for water. You know, God is good with his promises, and he has promised us water to take care of the problem, making this a glorious day to be alive.
Amen. Thank you, Bob. Good morning, everybody. Good to see you. We've got a small crowd here in the sanctuary and some wonderful souls on Zoom. Wherever you are in your easy chairs or your little purplish chairs here. Welcome. It's good to be with this community always. Thinking about where we've been in these last few years, oh my goodness. This community has sustained so many of us, and we are so grateful for it. Grateful for this practice of weekly gathering. Let's start our worship as we do with just a moment of silent meditation. Let's bring our whole selves into this place, into this community of beautiful souls and before God. Amen. I'm going to invite Mike to lead us now in our call to worship. I'm just grateful for Mike and Margaret, who are both doing double duty this morning, as we had to scramble our volunteers a bit because of COVID. And so I give God thanks for Mike leading us now. Would you, if you are in the sanctuary, would you rise as you are able? Let's hear now our call to worship.
We stretch.
We practice.
We run.
We bleed.
We cry.
We heal.
We run again.
We cheer.
We console.
We rest.
We win.
Amen. And thank you, Mike. Now, Mindy will lead us in our opening hymn, this wonderful Mark Miller anthem, All My Days. Be seated.
Let us join now in the unison prayer of confession and assurance of pardon. Holy One, forgive us for chasing after perishable wreaths, prizes of fame and wealth and power over. Forgive us when we give up too easily or try to take shortcuts to win at all costs. Or sabotage others for our own victories. Have mercy on us. Now let us join in silent confession. Hear this good news, beloveds. In the name of Jesus Christ, we are forgiven. Glory to God. Amen.
Need me.
Amen. I'm going to invite now Colette up to lead us in our epistle reading. This is from Paul's first letter to the Corinthians, chapter 9, verses 24 to 27.
Know that in a race, everyone runs, but only one wins the prize. So run in such a way as to win. Athletes deny themselves all sorts of things. They do this to win a laurel wreath, even though it withers. We, on the other hand, do so to win an imperishable crown. I don't run like the one who loses sight of the finish line. I don't fight as if I were beating the air. What I do is discipline my body and keep it under control, for fear that, after having preached to others, I myself should be disqualified. The word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God.
Thanks be to God. Thank you, Colette. Let's take a moment to pray. God, thank you for this journey, this race of life. We thank you for our companions, our teammates, the folks who are here in this space, the folks who surround us in our ancestry, the folks that we dream of, that motivate us to the finish line. We pray that on this day, that the words of my mouth and the meditations of all of our hearts would be acceptable to you, our rock and our redeemer. Amen. Hello, hello. So I am back from some time with my family, and I'm really grateful to Katie and Pastor Paul and Maggie and John and everybody who led this congregation while I was away. It was important for us to be with our family in the last few weeks. And as you know, I will be away next week. And this is a trip that I'm really excited about. Anybody who's talked to me recently knows I'm very excited. My husband and I are celebrating our 15th wedding anniversary with our first international trip in more than a decade. And we're going to go to, anybody know who's been around me? Greece. You cannot even know how much I am nerding out about Greece right now. I'm surprising even myself with my nerdiness. I've been reading fiction novels about the Trojan War. I didn't think I would. I've been listening to a podcast that I found that is an old Yale undergraduate class on the history of Greece, which when I finish it, and I'm going to finish it, will be more than 24 hours of lecture about Homeric epics and ancient Greek battle armor and Persian invaders. This is literally my joy right now. I am all Greece all the time. And it's because this is a culture and a place that greatly influenced the first Christians, who I think about all the time. So I'm very excited about this trip. And this is actually why I chose this week's scripture passage, which is a letter that Paul writes to people in Greece. The Corinthians are in the Greek city of Corinth, and Paul is talking about this very big Greek practice of these sports competitions. Now, we know about this. The most famous of the Greek sports competitions was the Olympics. So the Olympics was one of the things that made Greece, Greece, right? City-states from all over that were usually fighting each other for territory and all that, murdering one another over this and that squabble. They would all come together for these games because they all spoke Greek. And it wasn't just the Olympic Games that happened. There were several big inter-Greek games for all the Greek people. And one of them actually happened in Corinth. So the Corinthians, to whom Paul was addressing this letter, would have been very familiar with these kinds of games, because every few years their city hosted these huge games called the Isthmian Games. Can you say it with me? Isthmian Games, because Corinth is on the Isthmus of Corinth, which is a land bridge between the mainland and this other big chunk of land called the Peloponnese. So the Isthmian Games happened there in Corinth, very much like the Olympics, with all the classic competitions, the boxing and the racing and the wrestling and the singing and the poetry. Oh, you didn't know that singers and poets were considered athletes in ancient Greece. Well, that was a thing. That was a thing. Okay, so all this to say that Paul uses this sports metaphor, not just because he's like one of those sports fan who always talks about the Boston Red Sox or whatever. But he talks about sports because he knows people in the city of Corinth understood these games and they cared about these games. So the Christian life, he says, is like competing in the Isthmian Games. You know the Isthmian Games, right, Corinthians, right? It's like Paul writing to the people, if Paul wrote to the people of New Haven, Paul would be like, you know, the Christian life is like when your friend comes in from out of state, so you take him to Pepe's and have to stand outside for an hour waiting for a table, and the whole time you're crossing your fingers, really hoping that your friend will actually like pizza with clams on it. Am I right, New Haveners, right? You can all fill out that metaphor at lunch. So Paul's trying to be like hip to the kiddos in Corinth. He's trying to give them a metaphor that they're going to understand. So he's like, being Christian is being like an athlete at your famous games. Those athletes work hard. They condition their bodies. They practice every day. They work hard day in and day out to come to this big competition. Now, I don't know if you saw my video in this week's email. YouTube tells me that at least 14 of you did see it. But if you saw it, you would know that I was shockingly once actually an athlete. This is because for 13 years of my childhood, I was a gymnast and I was a strong girl. When we did state testing in elementary school gym, I beat out all the boys with my like 15 pull-ups, and my body was just like freakishly and oddly proportioned in its strength. My teammates called me ribs because my back muscles were so ripped that my rib cage was really expansive. I was saying in the video that I couldn't wear a lot of those pretty little prom dresses because my trapezius was so jacked. I couldn't get the zippers all the way up. I was a big wad of muscle when I was young. And I worked hard for that strength. Not only, you know, all the conditioning of the body and the working out, but I ate really healthy. Does anybody here eat at McDonald's? Yes. So with their delicious hamburgers and their amazing salty fries and the milkshakes and the apple pies. You know what I used to get at McDonald's as a kid? The grilled chicken sandwich. Yeah, that's all I ate at McDonald's. That's pretty healthy eating for a kid, right? And I wasn't trying to like lose weight. I wasn't on a diet. Muscle weighs more than fat, just FYI. I just wanted my body to be super healthy. You know, I wanted to be in the best shape I could be because I had a goal. I wanted to be a great gymnast. I wanted to be able to do the flips and the bar routines and the vaults. I wanted to win the competitions. And that's what Paul is talking about, right? He's like, Think about your spiritual journey like you're training for a sport. Athletes have these patterns of life, these habits, these practices that they do day in and day out, like pull-ups and eating grilled chicken sandwiches at McDonald's, things like that. They don't get strong and skilled overnight. It takes years and years of these practices, these patterns of life, for them to become physically strong, for them to break open the zippers of prom dresses. And it's the same with our spiritual life. We don't get spiritually grounded and strong overnight. I want you to think about the people in your life who are the most spiritually grounded. How do you think they got that way? I'm guessing that for most of them, they didn't just overnight have some kind of a lightning strike revelation from the heavens. Something like that might have started them on their journey. But for most spiritually grounded, spiritually strong people, they become that way because of these life practices, these life patterns, because they kind of train their brain through practice, through spiritual practice, to turn toward their spiritual center in times of hardship and temptation and beauty in their lives. So in my video this week, I asked, you know, what patterns are you noticing in your life? What patterns are you doing? What practices are you doing? Like, we brush our teeth to keep our teeth healthy. That's a very strong habit that many of us have, hopefully, most of us. What spiritual practices, habits do you have? I wonder if there's anyone here who, when you're anxious, you pick up your smartphone and you look something up, or you start scrolling headlines, or you start scrolling social media. I'm not going to ask you to raise your hands because I'm guessing it's kind of a lot of you who do this. We've formed these habits of life without even noticing. If you don't think that you do that, if you have a smartphone, I want you to pay attention today to when you pick it up and think about, like, why did I just pick this up? Think about that. We form these habits. Before smartphones, when I was anxious, I might have prayed. I didn't have this to pick up. I might have journaled. I might have called somebody that I trust. But I've noticed more and more that instead of doing those things, when I'm anxious or I'm uncomfortable, I pick up my device and I Google something like, why is my dog destroying my yard? It's making me very anxious. Or I scroll social media because I'm feeling kind of lonely. That's a spiritual habit, but it's reaching toward the wrong source. It's making me spiritually weak instead of spiritually strong. Habits and patterns of life are very important. If you've been here very long, you may know that one of my very favorite thinkers is this person named Adrienne Marie Brown. And Adrienne Marie Brown sometimes tells this story about when she was working on electoral organizing in 2004. This was after 9/11. This was when the US was waging war in Iraq and Afghanistan. It was this very anxious time. And she was talking about how all of the progressive organizing was about getting George W. Bush out of office. And there was this feeling that if you could just change the president, you could change the world. And she had this realization while she was doing that work that the president is only the top layer of a big cake. And even if you change that top layer, you still have all those layers below that are still the same old, same old. They're still functioning in the same messed up, undemocratic, violent ways. We want to fight for our democracy in the big elections. But even in our little progressive organizations, she was realizing, we don't make room for all voices. We don't make decisions democratically. We want the president to stop all the wars, but even in our families, we don't know how to solve conflict without hurting each other. It's easier to go to an anti-war demonstration than to confront conflict well within our own homes. So even if we stop all the wars, even if we got rid of our military and all the police, there's still going to be conflict. And if we don't know how to solve conflict in healthy ways in our own communities, if we don't have good practices and patterns in our own lives, what are we going to advocate our government to do about conflict? We won't know what to advocate for because we still solve conflict in our homes in patterns of retribution and toxic power dynamics. So even if you change what's going on at the top, all of our patterns of life, all of our habits with each other are still the same. And things don't really change. Adrienne Marie Brown always quotes Grace Lee Boggs, who said, transform yourself to transform the world. The world will never really change unless we change the patterns and the practices at the root. Unless we change our habits of confronting conflict in our church. Unless we develop real democratic patterns and practices in our workplaces and in our book clubs and in our Girl Scout troops, so that everyone knows that they're valued and has a seat at the table. That's real democracy. These habits and these practices and patterns of everyday life and community are the pathway to changing the world, to becoming a strong, democratic, and compassionate nation. We've got to train ourselves to be compassionate, to be spiritually strong, if we ever want to change anything sustainably. Which brings me to the prize. Paul says, engage in all this spiritual discipline, these hard patterns of life, get yourself spiritually jacked, so that you can win the prize. So what is the prize of the Christian life? What is worth reorienting our life practices for? Now, when I was growing up in the church, that was a very easy question. Our prize is eternal life, period. Our prize is that one day we'll all get to live in some cloudy paradise on an eternal Saturday morning, sipping mimosas with nothing to do but smile at each other. Or the prize is avoiding the fires of hell. That's the prize. Now, today, you know, I don't believe that the Christian church is the only ticket to heaven or whatever. I do believe that one day we will have to somehow, in some sense, stand before our God and account for our lives, for our church, for our community, and our nation. Maybe we're doing that every single day, every moment. But it has always seemed kind of self-centered to me, just to be doing all this in life so that you yourself can live forever in heaven, whatever that means to you. Can that really be like why Mother Teresa lived her life the way she did? Can that really be why Dr. King lived his life and died his death the way he did? Were they just hoping to secure for themselves heavenly bliss? I have to believe there's a loftier prize. That this race we're running is not only a race away from hell, but that it's a race toward something greater. So what's the prize for you? Why do you come here? Why do you do this? Why do you do spiritual disciplines? I'll tell you why I'm running this race. In my years on this planet, I've witnessed a very broken world. I've witnessed war and corruption, scapegoating, poverty, hypocrisy. I've witnessed the degradation of and violence toward women and queer folks treated as normal and okay. I've witnessed friends made to feel unworthy and dirty in the name of God. I've witnessed children in cages and backs broken in the back of police vans in this so-called enlightened civilization. And I have witnessed myself participating in all of these things. But I have also witnessed an alternative world. I have also witnessed transformation and unexpected compassion. I have also witnessed goodness and martyrdom and sunsets that feel like they were painted just for me. I have also witnessed justice and revolutionary love, rain that smells like spring, children that know not prejudice. I have also witnessed God made manifest in a dying person with cancer and someone who is incarcerated. And in the sweet memory of my mom's homemade gooseberry pie, I know that God is here, creating a kingdom in the midst of our humble planet, in spite of all of our bad decisions. And I have also witnessed myself and all of you participating in all of these good things. And this matters so insanely much. The kingdom of God is here. And we have the privilege of helping to build it up. That is the prize. And it matters. It's the difference between good and evil. It's the difference between a world dominated by hatred and willful ignorance and sin and a world full of human flourishing and beauty and love and justice. And I want to win that prize. Anybody else? I want to be on the winning team with all of you. And to do that, we get to do the work, form the practices, set the patterns that will make us strong so that we can win that victory. Amen. Let's sing now together. This is one of our great spiritual practices, song. Mindy's gonna lead us along with Bob in our next hymn. If you're in the sanctuary and you would like to rise, please rise as you are able. Let's sing together, My Life Flows On.
Oh,
One of our spiritual practices in this church is to take a moment to let folks in the congregation voice their prayers to God through this community. And sometimes I think about what that kind of practice does to us, what kind of shaping that does for us and for our church as a community, and as we go out into the world, what it means to have heard in your ears every Sunday the concerns and the victories of the people in this church. Something to think about as we share with one another. I'll invite anybody in the congregation to offer a prayer, a joy, concern, and if you remember, you can say, Lord, in your mercy, and we'll all answer, hear our prayer.
Okay, I'm going to invite us all now then to join in the prayer that Jesus taught us to pray. Shall we pray together? Our God who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. And forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Send it back to the sanctuary with you, Pastor Vicki.
Thank you, Reverend Smith. Thank you all. You know, as this COVID wave comes through again, I just a little bit like, you get all those fears of the various waves that have happened in the last few years. But I am also just reminded of how we have ridden all those waves together as a community, and how grateful I am for this church and for all of you and for your contributions. Again, like, we've had some shakeups in volunteers this morning because of COVID, and that's just, everything has been so unpredictable, but people have just stepped up in this community, both with your time and energy and your work and with your financial contributions. It's just been amazing, and y'all are awesome, and so grateful to have this sustaining community. And this is the time when we will give God thanks for this community and give our offerings. And you can give offerings through fsumc.org, through the mail, or there's a little brown offering box in the back of the church. This is also the time when we ask you to, in the sanctuary, to fill out your little blue cards or white cards. They might be white, so that if we need to do contact tracing, we know who you are and who was here this week. So put this also in the little brown box after the service. And Bob's gonna play us some music while we offer those things.
Thank you.
You may be seated. Just a few things that I want you to look out for in this upcoming week's email. One is that our own Reverend Taryn Lepke is doing voting organizing. He's been organizing for years around voting rights. That is his ministry in the church. And he is going to be helping out with some polling station volunteering, so people can volunteer just to be present at the polls to make sure everything is going okay for folks, and to register any complaints that people have. And also you can do it online. So look out for that. There are going to be some trainings that he's going to help run in the coming weeks for that, for the August primary. I also just want to put out there that there is an event that our neighbor church, Hamden Plains UMC, is going to be putting on with Pastor Jeremiah and the young Persia Delgado, who we know here in this church. They will be helping to create this wonderful afternoon experience at the Green in Hamden, and it's going to be an arts showcase for young people. So if you know any young people who want to showcase art, let me know. And also there'll be food and music, and it's just going to be just a fun community time. And I would love for our church to really show up and support this event. So look out for that in this week's email. It's August 26th. I've signed us up for a booth. We're going to have a booth there. So if you have any booth ideas, you let me know. Anybody's spiritual gift, outdoor boothing? Because I want to know. We're going to have a good time. So it's August 26th. Look for that in your emails. And I will be, yes, on vacation from tomorrow till the 27th. And Reverend Dr. Christine Stavka is going to be covering for me with Reverend Lepke as kind of a backup, just in case she's on call at the hospital at that time. So all that information is at the end of your worship guides and in the weekly email. All right. Well, and I hope you all have a wonderful time next week with Maggie Carr, who will be preaching on prayer. All right. Finally, we are going to sing together this song, I'll Fly Away. This is, I think, a favorite tune for a lot of us. And it really speaks, I think the spirit of it is to speak to the prize of, I think it can be read as like the eternal life prize. But I want us to reframe it in our minds as I think the way I think of it is this, the prize of a life well lived, of a life that's really participated in the life of God in this precious time that we've had on earth. And many of us can think of saints in our lives who have been spiritually grounded and have participated in that life so well. And this is inspiration for us to also find that way of participating in God's eternal life in the day to day. So let's rise as you are able, and we'll sing I'll Fly Away. Amen. Well, my spiritual athletes, you have done another practice today on the way toward transforming the world. May you take this strength out into the world and make it better, make it more and more like the kingdom of God that you know is present in this world. Amen. Hi, I'm Reverend Vicki Flippin, pastor at First and Summerfield United Methodist Church in New Haven, Connecticut, and we're so glad to have had you in worship today. We would love to stay in touch with you to know who you are and to let you know what we're doing in our community during this time. So we invite you to send an email to fsumcworship@gmail.com, and we can't wait to hear from you. Have a wonderful week. Stay safe, be blessed, and let's continue to participate in all that God is doing in the world. Bye.